Today, the 15th of July, 2009. Now we come to the second chapter of the Samyutta Nikaya. This is the Devaputta Samyutta. Deva, you know, is a heavenly being. And Putta is son, son of a Deva. So this chapter concerns the sons of Devas, which means young Devas, Devas who have been reborn not so long in the heavens. Now the first chapter I will read is the first sutta I will read is 2.6, Kamada Sutta. At Savati, standing to one side, the young Deva, Kamada, said to the Blessed One, "Hard to do, Blessed One, very hard to do, Blessed One." And the Buddha replied, "They do even what is hard to do. The trainees endowed with virtue, steadfast. For one who has entered the homeless life, contentment brings along happiness." And then the Deva Kamada again said, "That is hard to gain, Blessed One, namely contentment." And the Buddha replied, "They gain even what is hard to gain, O Kamada, who delight in calming the mind, whose minds day and night take delight in development." And Kamada said, "That is hard to concentrate, Blessed One, namely the mind." And the Buddha said, "They concentrate even what is hard to concentrate, who delight in calming the faculties. Having cut through the net of death, the noble ones, O Kamada, go their way." And Kamada said, "The path is impassable and uneven, Blessed One." And the Buddha said, "Though the path is impassable and uneven, the noble ones walk it, Kamada. The ignoble ones fall head down first, right there on the uneven path. But the path of the noble ones is even, for the noble are even amidst the uneven." That's the end of the sutta. So according to the commentaries, this Kamada used to be a monk. And he didn't succeed in the holy life because his mind was very disturbed. So after he passed away, he was reborn in heaven. And that's why he came to see the Buddha and said that this holy life is very hard to practice. But the Buddha said, even if it's hard to practice also, the trainees, they practice it. And the Buddha said, contentment brings along happiness. Then he said, it's very hard to get contentment. And Buddha said, even what is hard to get, they get, they calm their mind. Take delight in development. Development should be the word bhavana. Bhavana sometimes is taken to mean meditation. But the actual meaning of bhavana is development of the mind. Because an ordinary mind is covered by the five hindrances, which make us what we call blur. We don't see things clearly and we don't have wisdom. So when we practice meditation and we attain calm, the hindrances go away. The Buddha says the hindrances are eliminated when we attain the jhanas. Although the roots have not been plucked out, but the Buddha says they are eliminated. They don't trouble that person anymore. And so meditation is a process of developing the mind, getting rid of the hindrances. And then Kamada said it's very hard to concentrate the mind. And then the Buddha said, even though it's very hard, they concentrate the mind and calm the faculties. So, this is about a Deva who was a monk and did not succeed, found the holy life so difficult. The next sutta, 2.8, Tayana Sutta, at Savati. Then when the night had advanced, the young Deva Tayana, formerly the founder of a religious sect, of stunning beauty, illuminating the entire Jetas Grove, approached the Blessed One. Having approached, he paid homage to the Blessed One, stood to one side and recited these verses in the presence of the Blessed One. Having exerted oneself, cut the stream, dispel sensual desires, O Brahmana. Without having abandoned sensual desires, a sage does not reach unity. If one would do what should be done, one should firmly exert oneself. For a slack, wondrous life only scatters more dust. Better left undone is the misdeed, a deed that later brings repentance. Better done is the good deed, which when done is not repented. As kusa grass, wrongly grasped, only cuts one's hand, so the ascetic life, wrongly taken up, drags one down to hell. Any deed that is slackly done, any corrupted vow, a holy life that breeds suspicion, does not yield great fruit. This is what the young Deva, Tayana, said. Having said this, he paid homage to the Blessed One, and keeping him on the right, he disappeared right there. Then when the night had passed, the Blessed One addressed the monks thus, "Monks, last night when the night had advanced, the young Deva Tayana, formerly the founder of a religious sect, approached me and in my presence recited these verses." And the Buddha repeated the verses. This is what the young Deva Tayana said. Having said this, he paid homage to me, and keeping me on the right, he disappeared right there. Learn Tayana's verses, monks. Master Tayana's verses, monks. Remember Tayana's verses, monks. Tayana's verses are beneficial, monks. They pertain to the fundamentals of the holy life. It's the end of the sutta. So you see, this Tayana formerly was the founder of a religious sect. That means he was also an ascetic or a monk. And having been a good monk, probably, he was reborn in heaven. So here, he is giving some advice to the monks. So he is telling it to the Buddha so that the Buddha can tell the monks. So these verses are very good. It's very suitable for a monk. That's why normally these verses after the monks are 2-weekly uposatha recitation. Every 2 weeks the monks recite the precepts. So after reciting the precepts, generally the monks will recite these verses. Here I read the second line, having exerted oneself, cut the stream, dispel sensual desires, O Brahmana. This word Brahmana means a religious man. Brahmana was formerly the priest, the priest sect. So nowadays, because a lot of these people who belong to the priest sect, they are no more practicing like priests. So nowadays they are called Brahmins. So here the translation is Brahmin. But actually it does not refer to the Brahmin caste. It refers to a religious person. So he says, without exerting oneself, having exerted oneself, cut the stream. Stream, I guess, of... stream of life or stream of craving. This is without abandoning sensual desires, a sage cannot attain one-pointedness of mind, jhanas. And then basically saying that a monk, if he does not lead a holy life properly, then he can go down to hell. As kusa grass, wrongly grasped, only cuts one's hand, so the ascetic life, wrongly taken up, drags one down to hell. Kusa grass is a bit like our lalang. Or lalang. If you pull the lalang, it can cut your hand. The next sutta is 2.10 at Savati. Now on that occasion, the young Deva, Surya, had been seized by Rahu, Lord of the Asuras. Then recollecting the Blessed One, the young Deva, Surya, on that occasion recited this verse. Let homage be to you, the Buddha. O hero, you are everywhere released. I have fallen into captivity, so please be my refuge. Then referring to the young Deva, Surya, the Blessed One addressed Rahu, Lord of the Asuras, in verse. Surya has gone for refuge to the Tathagata, the Arahant. Release Surya, O Rahu. Buddhas have compassion for the world. While moving across the sky, O Rahu, do not swallow the Radiant One, the Maker of Light in darkness, the disc of fiery might in the gloom. Rahu, release my child Surya. Then Rahu, Lord of the Asuras, released the young Deva Surya and hurriedly approached Vepachiti, Lord of the Asuras. Having approached, shocked and terrified, he stood to one side. Then as he stood there, Vepachiti, Lord of the Asuras, addressed him in verse, "Why, Rahu, do you come in a hurry? Why did you release Surya? Having come as if in shock, why do you stand there frightened?" And he said, "My head would have split in 7 parts. While living, I would have found no ease if, when chanted over by the Buddha's verses, I had not let go of Surya." That's the end of the sutta. Here, actually, Rahu is the biggest of the asuras. It's a very huge deva. So sometimes there are drawings of Rahu swallowing the moon or swallowing the sun. Actually, that is symbolic. There are two similar suttas here. One is this Rahu, being a very huge size, he caught this moon god, Chandima. And the same thing happened. Probably he wanted to eat this, kill this Chandima. So in this sutta, he caught the sun god Surya and wanted to kill him. So, but this Surya called out to the Buddha for help. Then the Buddha immediately shouted to Rahu to release this Surya, the sun god. And so he quickly released him and went back to his heaven, shaking like a leaf. So Vepachiti is one of the leaders of the Asuras. This Rahu is not actually a leader, but he is the biggest in size. So Vipachiti asked him, "Why are you trembling like a leaf?" He said, "If he had not released Surya, his head would have split in 7 pieces. So when the Buddha says something and you go against his word, it is possible that this would happen. Now the next sutta I'm going to read is 2.15, Chandana Sutta. Standing to one side, the young Deva Chandana addressed the Blessed One in verse, "Who here crosses over the flood, unwearying by day and night? Who does not sing in the deep, without support, without a hold? One always..." And then the Buddha replied, "One always perfect in virtue, endowed with wisdom, well concentrated, one energetic and resolute, crosses the flood so hard to cross. One who desists from sensual perception, who has overcome the fetter of form, who has destroyed delight in existence, he does not sink in the deep." It's the end of the sutta. Here, who crosses over the flood? The flood is the waters of samsara. It's symbolic. If a person is liberated, he crosses the flood, he goes over to the other shore. So he's asking, who does not sing in the deep? The deep is the ocean of samsara, the ocean of the round of rebirths. So the Buddha said, one who is perfect in virtue, well concentrated and endowed with wisdom, energetic and resolute, will cross the flood. So here the three things are important: sila, samadhi, and panya. Virtue or moral conduct, that is the basic. If a person has moral conduct, then when he practices meditation, it's easier for him to gain the second step, which is concentration. And when he has concentration, then wisdom will come. But the Buddha says he has to be energetic and resolute. Very, very diligent, hardworking. Next sutta is 2.17. Standing to one side, the young Deva Subrahma addressed the Blessed One in verse, "Always frightened is this mind. The mind is always agitated about unarisen problems,
and about arisen ones. If there exists release from fear, being asked, please declare it to me. And the Buddha said, not apart from enlightenment and austerity, not apart from restraint of the sense faculties, not apart from relinquishing all, do I see any safety for living beings. This is what the Blessed One said. And the young Deva disappeared right there. So here this Deva, apparently, his mind is always agitated and frightened. Problems have not come, he's worried about them. Present problems are also, he's fearful. And he asked the Buddha what to do. Then the Buddha says, not apart from relinquishing all, do I see any safety for living beings. So the Buddha is saying, unless we let go of everything, let go of the world, then there is no safety. There's no safety because we will experience aging, sickening, and dying. So only when a person has become enlightened, that he attains the deathless. So when a person becomes enlightened, even though the body dies, he does not feel I die. He knows the body dies. There's no more I for him, no more self. So the Buddha says, you have to attain enlightenment. You have to practice austerities, restraint of the sense faculties, letting go everything. Then only you have security. Otherwise, as long as we have not attained any stage, other stages, the woeful planes of existence were still waiting for us. We will definitely keep being reborn in the ghostly realm, the animal realm, and the hell realm. 2.20 Anathapindika Sutta. Standing to one side, the young Deva Anathapindika recited these verses in the presence of the Blessed One. This indeed is the Jeta's Grove, the resort of this order of seers, or the Sangha of seers, dwelt in by the Dhamma King, Dhammaraja, a place that gives me joy. Action, knowledge, righteousness, virtue, and excellent life, by this are mortals purified, not by clan or wealth. Therefore, a person who is wise, out of regard for his own good, should carefully examine the Dhamma. Thus he is purified in it. Sariputta truly is endowed with wisdom, with virtue, and with inner peace. Even a monk who has gone beyond, at best, can only equal him. This is what the young Deva Anathapindika said. Having said this, he paid homage to the Blessed One, and keeping him on the right, he disappeared right there. Then when the night had passed, the Blessed One addressed the monks thus. Monks, last night, when the night had advanced, a young Deva approached me, and in my presence recited these verses, and the Buddha repeated the verses. This is what the young Deva said. Having said this, he paid homage to me, and keeping me on the right, he disappeared right there. When this was said, the Venerable Ananda said to the Blessed One, Venerable Sir, the young Deva must surely have been Anathapindika. For Anathapindika, the householder, had full confidence in the Venerable Sariputta. And the Buddha said, good, good, Ananda, you have drawn the right inference by reasoning. For that young Deva, Ananda, was Anathapindika. And that's the end of the sutta. So I'm reading this sutta to you, just to let you know that Anathapindika, after he passed away, he was born in the heaven. According to the books, I think he was born in the Tusita heaven. This Anathapindika, he was a great admirer of Sariputta. So, even when he spoke to the Buddha, he praised Sariputta, saying that any monk, even he has become enlightened, can only, at the best, equal Sariputta, can never be better than Sariputta. A lot of lay people like that, I like that. Lay people have their favorite monk. 2.26 Rohitasa Sutta is a very interesting sutta. At Savati, standing to one side, the young Deva Rohitasa said to the Blessed One, "Is it possible, Venerable Sir, by traveling to know or to see or to reach the end of the world, where one is not born, does not age, does not die, does not pass away, and is not reborn?" And the Buddha said, "As to that end of the world, friend, where one is not born, does not age, does not die, does not pass away, and is not reborn, I say that it cannot be known, seen, or reached by traveling." And the Deva said, "It is wonderful, Venerable Sir. It is amazing, Venerable Sir, how well this was stated by the Blessed One. Once in the past, Venerable Sir, I was a seer or an ascetic named Rohitasa, son of Bhoja, possessed of spiritual power, able to travel through the sky. My speed was such, Venerable Sir, that I could move just as swiftly as a firm bow archer who can hold the bow firmly. Trained, skillful, practiced, experienced, could easily shoot past the shadow of a palmyra tree with a light arrow. My stride was such, Venerable Sir, that it seemed to reach from the eastern ocean to the western ocean. Then, Venerable Sir, the wish arose in me, I will reach the end of the world by traveling. Possessing such speed and such stride, and having a lifespan of 100 years, living for 100 years, I traveled for 100 years without pausing, except to eat, drink, take meals and snacks, to defecate and urinate, to sleep and dispel fatigue. Yet I died along the way without having reached the end of the world." It is wonderful, Venerable Sir. It is amazing, Venerable Sir, how well this was stated by the Blessed One. As to that end of the world, friend, where one is not born, does not age, does not die, does not pass away, and is not reborn, I say that it cannot be known, seen, or reached by traveling. And the Buddha said, "However, friend, I say that without having reached the end of the world, there is no making an end to suffering. It is, friend, in just this fathom-high carcass, endowed with perception and mind, that I make known the world, the origin of the world, the cessation of the world, and the way leading to the cessation of the world. The world's end can never be reached by means of traveling. Yet without reaching the world's end, there is no release from suffering. Therefore, truly, the world knower, the wise one, gone to the world's end, fulfiller of the holy life, having known the world's end, at peace, longs not for this world or another." So here, this sutta is about Deva, who was formerly an ascetic with psychic power. And then he felt that this world was full of suffering. So he thought he wants to get out of this world of suffering and go to a place where there is no aging, where there is no sickening, and no dying, and no being reborn. So he thought with his great psychic power, he could fly so fast. Eventually, one day, he will come to the end of the world and get out of the world. So he said that for 100 years, he kept flying without much wasting time until he died. He could not find the end of the world. Actually, according to the Buddha, space, there is no limit to the ends of space. Space is boundless, no limitless. That's why if you keep flying, you can never reach the end of space. So the Buddha said, but without coming to the end of the world, you cannot get out of suffering. And then the Buddha says, it is in this body itself, is the world, is the beginning of the world, the end of the world. The way going to the end of the world is all within this body. Why? Because within our body is consciousness. Consciousness dwells within our body. And the world is in consciousness. Consciousness only exists the world only exists when there is consciousness. Right? So to reach the end of the world, you have to reach the end of consciousness. And since consciousness is within us, we have to go inside us and find the origin of consciousness. If we can come to the state where consciousness ceases, that is the end of the world. So the end of the world is not out there somewhere. The only place, in fact, the world itself, the beginning of the world, the end of the world, everything is within us. 2.29, Susima Sutta, Asavati. Then the Venerable Ananda approached the Blessed One, paid homage to him and sat down to one side. The Blessed One then said to him, "Do you too, Ananda, approve of Sariputta?" And Ananda said, "Indeed, Venerable Sir, who would not approve of the Venerable Sariputta unless he were foolish, full of hatred, deluded, or mentally deranged? The Venerable Sariputta, Venerable Sir, is wise, one of great wisdom, of wide wisdom, of joyous wisdom, of swift wisdom, of sharp wisdom, of penetrative wisdom. The Venerable Sariputta, Pante, has few wishes. He is content, secluded, aloof, energetic. The Venerable Sariputta, Venerable Sir, is one who gives advice, one who accepts advice, a reprover, one who censures evil. Indeed, Venerable Sir, who would not approve of the Venerable Sariputta unless he were foolish, full of hatred, deluded, or mentally deranged?" And the Buddha said, "So it is, Ananda, so it is. Indeed, Ananda, who would not approve of Sariputta unless he were foolish, full of hatred, deluded, or mentally deranged? Sariputta, Ananda, is wise, etc." So the Buddha repeated exactly what Ananda said. So while this praise of the Venerable Sariputta was being spoken, the young Deva Susima, accompanied by a great assembly of young Devas, approached the Blessed One. Having approached, he paid homage to the Blessed One, stood to one side and said to him, "So it is, Blessed One, so it is, Fortunate One. Indeed, Venerable Sir, who would not approve of the Venerable Sariputta?" And he also repeated exactly what Venerable Ananda said. "In my case too, Venerable Sir, no matter what assembly of young Devas I have approached, I have often heard this same report. The Venerable Sariputta is wise, etc., etc. Who would not approve of the Venerable Sariputta unless he were foolish, full of hatred, deluded, or mentally deranged?" Let's stop here for a moment. So here this Deva is also praising the Venerable Sariputta. And this Deva is saying, whenever he meets other Devas, he hears other Devas also full of praise for the Venerable Sariputta. And this is quite the opposite of what the later Mahayana books say. The later Mahayana books always like to put down the Venerable Sariputta. Then while this praise of the Venerable Sariputta was being spoken, the young Devas in Susima's assembly, elated, gladdened, full of rapture and joy, displayed diverse lustrous colors, just as a beryl gem, beautiful, of fine quality, eight-faceted, of excellent workmanship, and placed on a brocade cloth, shines and beams and radiates. So too the young Devas in Susima's assembly displayed diverse lustrous colors. And just as an ornament of finest gold, very skillfully burnished in a furnace by an adroit goldsmith, and placed on a brocade cloth, shines and beams and radiates. So too the young Devas in Susima's assembly displayed diverse lustrous colors. And just as when the night is fading, the morning star shines and beams and radiates, so too the young Devas in Susima's assembly displayed diverse lustrous colors. And just as in the autumn, when the sky is clear and cloudless, the sun ascending in the sky dispels all darkness from space as it shines and beams and radiates, so too the young Devas in Susima's assembly, elated, gladdened, full of rapture and joy, displayed diverse lustrous colors. Then with reference to the Venerable Sariputta, the young Deva Susima recited this verse in the presence of the Blessed One. "He is widely known to be a wise man, Sariputta, who is free of anger, of few wishes, gentle, tame, the seer, adorned by the teacher's praise." Then the Blessed One, with reference to the Venerable Sariputta, replied to the young Deva Susima in verse, "He is widely known to be a wise man, Sariputta, who is free of anger, of few wishes, gentle, tamed, developed, well-tamed, he awaits the time." That's the end of the sutta. So here you see, even the Buddha also praises the Venerable Sariputta. So in the end, the Buddha says, is waiting his time. He's waiting his time to enter Nirvana. Sometimes, like the Buddha says, they have done their work, so just waiting to collect collect the salary like that. So in the original suttas, you find Sariputta is always praised by humans and devas, because remember Sariputta is the monk with the highest wisdom, and the Buddha says that Venerable Sariputta turns the Dharma wheel exactly like the Buddha himself. 2.30, that's what I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was dwelling at Rajagaha in the bamboo grove, the squirrel sanctuary. Then when the night had advanced, a number of young devas, disciples of various sectarian teachers, Asama and Sahali and Ninka and Akotaka and Vitambari and Mana Vagamiya, of stunning beauty, illuminating the entire bamboo grove, approached the Blessed One. Having approached, they paid homage to the Blessed One and stood to one side. Then standing to one side, the young Deva Asama spoke this verse, referring to Purana Kasapa in the presence of the Blessed One. In injuring and killing here, in beating and extortion, Kasapa did not recognize evil, nor see any merit for oneself. He indeed taught what is worthy of trust. That teacher deserves esteem. Then the young Deva Sahali spoke this verse referring to Makali Gosala in the presence of the Blessed One. By austerity and scrupulousness, he attained complete self-restraint. He abandoned contentious talk with people, refrained from falsehood, a speaker of truth. Surely such a one does no evil. Then the young Deva Ninka spoke this verse referring to Nigantha Nataputta in the presence of the Blessed One. A scrupulous, discerning monk, well restrained by the four controls, explaining what is seen and heard, surely he could not be a sinner. Then the young Deva Akotaka spoke this verse referring to various sectarian teachers in the presence of the Blessed One. Pakudaka Katiyana and Niganta, along with Makali and Purana, teachers of companies, attained to ascetic stature. They were surely not far from superior men. Then the young Deva Vitambari replied to the young Deva Akotaka in verse, even by howling along, the wretched jackal remains a vile beast, never the lion's peer. So though he be the teacher of a group, the naked ascetic, speaker of falsehood, arousing suspicion by his conduct, bears no resemblance to superior men. Then Mara, the evil one, took possession of the young Deva Vitambari and recited this verse in the presence of the Blessed One. Those engaged in austerity and scrupulousness, those protecting their solitude, and those who have settled on form, delighting in the world of Devas, indeed, these mortals instruct rightly in regard to the other world. Then the Blessed One, having understood this is Mara the evil one, replied to Mara the evil one in verse, whatever forms exist here and beyond, and those of luminous beauty in the sky, all these indeed you praise, Namuchi, like bait thrown out for catching fish. Then in the Blessed One's presence, this Namuchi is another name for Mara. Mara is the Satan in Buddhism. So he's saying all these beautiful things that you praise, Mara, they are all your bait for catching living beings. This world, the Buddha says, all the delightful things in the world are all Mara's bait to catch us. Beautiful sights, nice sounds, nice smells, taste, touch, and thoughts. Then in the Blessed One's presence, the young Deva, Manavagamiya, recited these verses referring to the Blessed One. Vipula is called the best of mountains, among the hills of Rajagaha. Seta, the best of snow-clad mountains. The sun, the best of travelers in the sky. The ocean is the best body of water. The moon, the best of nocturnal lights. But in this world, together with its Devas, the Buddha is declared supreme. So, that's the end of the sutta. You see in this sutta that these devas, many of them were followers of external ascetic teachers who were famous during the Buddha's time. But the Buddha said their teachings were wrong. And in fact, in one sutta, the Buddha called one of these external sect teachers a fool, Makkali Gosalaputta. The Buddha says that fool Makkali is leading beings to the woeful plains of existence. Just like the fish trap leads the fish along the trap and goes into the stakes and then can never come out. So the Buddha says in the same way, Makkali is leading a lot of people to the woeful plains. And why? Because I think Makkali is one of those who says there is no karma vipaka. There's no result of karma. You can do what you like. There's no merit. There's no sin. Nothing. So, but you see, some of their followers, even though they follow the wrong teachers, because they probably were good at heart, so they did good things, so they are born in, reborn in heaven, not because of the teacher's doctrine helped them to be born in heaven. So it doesn't matter what religion we follow, as long as our heart is good, we don't do evil, we don't harm others, we help others, then we can go to heaven.